What year?
2018.
What happened here?
Judgment Day happened.
Our movie takes place after the bombs have gone off, so that's a huge point of separation from the first three movies.
When Victor and I were thinking about what our vision was for the movie, we met a lot of directors, a lot of people were interested in the project, and honestly, McGee wasn't even on our short list. And someone said, you should meet this guy, and he walked in, and really his vision was so close to what we'd seen in our mind's eyes. He just really got it.
Yeah! Yeah!
First I thought the idea of a Terminator 4 wasn't such a hot idea, but then I heard that the take was indeed post-Judgment Day, and that felt like an original point of entry and a great place to get in.
Unlike the flash forwards that they've seen from the other Terminators, Skynet is very much dominating, but it's still in a state of evolution.
This is the future. This is a different time. It's a different place. It's a different environment. So we have to have freedom to imagine what life could have been.
We didn't want to go to a futuristic future. The apocalypse happened, and from that moment on, there was no new technology, no new cars being built, no more food being grown.
We were creating a world that nobody has seen before. So we couldn't just create little pockets. Everywhere the camera sees is a world that nobody has seen.
So we picked through the debris of the current day and decided, what would civilization be like if it were stripped bare and all you had was what you needed to survive?
I didn't want a shiny robotic world. I didn't want a clean future. I really wanted a difficult, dirty future.
This is totally a different departure from mythology. It's gritty, it's more real and raw.
One of the things we're trying to do here is sort of turn the franchise up and down on its head. So I came up with the idea of the grittiness and the darkness so that it was just so totally different.
There's no such thing as a luxury in the Terminator Salvation world. So rather than populating it with new inventions and a shiny new future, we went the other way. We call it the retro future.
McGee's reality for this picture, he didn't want to replicate what Jim Cameron had done. He wanted to explore another side of it.
It was critical to me to create a tactile reality. I wanted the world to feel real. I didn't want to shoot actors emoting with C-stands and tennis balls against green screens. I wanted everything to be built. That's why we shot in New Mexico.
We're shooting T-Salvation in Albuquerque, New Mexico. I would say the look of the movie, a lot of it has kind of a Mad Max feel. And we're out here in the desert, so it's perfect for that, for the exterior locations.
We have probably 30, 40 locations. And it's a big logistical dance because we wanted to get as much money on the screen as you can.
I needed the desolate American West, or North Africa, or I suppose bits and pieces of Asia. But I really needed that David Lean expanse that suggests a world of difficulty, so you could taste it and feel it. I've always believed that the golden age of science fiction was sort of the late 70s, early 80s, but it was real fantasy then. And now we're living in an age where it's becoming reality. So what was once science fiction is now here.
I'm completely a sci-fi fan, but it has to be done in a very realistic way.
The whole movie's about where does humanity end and the idea of being a machine begin. Even though my body is that of a machine, I am indeed still a human being inside because I have free will and I have the ability to make choice.
The other three Terminators were set in the present and speculated on what happens when a futuristic creature visits the present. This installation of Terminator Salvation is the fourth in the series, but really it's a new beginning.
This is the world that no one's seen. This is the world that the Terminators and Kyle Reese come out of.
Because we're actually in this movie prior to the first three movies, we basically took the T-800 and we had to reverse engineer all the other ones back. So they had to be a little bit more brutal. They had to be a little bit bigger in the design. But then again, they still had to have the reality and the engineering of what a robot would do.
We see the research and development of the machines. They start very big and bulky and they get sleeker and more powerful. It's just fun looking at the different machines of this world because you want to see the success and failure of everything Skynet tried on their way to the T-800, their most proficient killing machine.
One of the biggest tasks was we are showing in this film the actual manufacturing of the Terminators and the factories and Skynet.
Well, here we are in the heart of it all. This is the Terminator factory. And this is the exciting part. We've never seen this before in any of the Terminator movies. Here we actually get to come to their home, see where they're being built. So we came to this wonderful old disused power plant, which is just down from the studio here in New Mexico. And we just came in and we dressed it. The thing was actually bright yellow and painted with primary colors when we first came in here. So we had to age it down, rust it down, put all the peely paint on it, and then bring it into the world of the Terminators.
Let's be intelligent, take a location that's got some natural things happening that we don't need to build. I mean, imagine if you had to construct that as a set element.
Yeah.
It'd be expensive, it'd be manpower, it'd be a big pain in the ass. Mm-hmm. This has a lot of good stuff. Take the vanilla yellow thing, take it all down, drippy Geiger thing, yeah. And we're really, really close.
So as you see, this is the world of our Terminators. Our Terminators are a lot darker now. They're a lot sort of oily, a lot greasy. Now this is in the world that they're being manufactured in. So here we have a whole series of robot arms that will come around and actually manufacture them. They'll be welding, they'll be putting arms in. Most of that's going to be added in afterwards in CG.
We began canvassing all the robot companies we could find so we could get full-scale operating assembly line robotics and actually incorporate them in our sets and figure out how they would be building Terminators. And we were able to create both the clean room Skynet labs and then the down and dirty factory where they're pumping out the Terminators.
Where'd you get that jacket?
The other guy didn't need it.
Take it off!
You point a gun at someone, you better be ready to pull the trigger.
Everything in the film had a very customized feel to it. What we did was we created a whole stock of clothes that were from various different sources. These are examples of the costume renderings that we did for Marcus. We knew that we wanted some sort of heroic coat for him for the first sequence of the film. The second costume that Marcus wears in the movie are these leathers, and we kind of like the idea of, you know, referring to Terminator films always have a Terminator in leathers, but we did our own post-apocalyptic version of leathers. So this is the first costume we see John Connor in, and we found this great vintage bomber jacket, and then we customized it for our knees. We made it nice and slim and so he could move around really easily. Everything in our world has this sense of being customized, especially for the characters. Everything goes through this process of individualization.
Honestly, I feel like Michael Wilkinson's design can be like a post-apocalyptic fashion line. And that's kind of what these films afford, is that it's the apocalypse, but we can have everyone look really good.
How come you're not wearing one of these?
Because I haven't earned mine yet.
There's all this mythology that we get to take part in sort of forming and shaping. So there was another opportunity for us to make these Terminators that didn't quite look as glossy as some of the previous ones.
We were designing at least 10 new Terminators. I've taken the silver Terminator and turned him into black, turned him into steel, turned him into that sort of gritty look of the reality of what metal does.
Stan Winston's team, headed by John Rosengrant on this picture, have done an incredible job. They've created an entire menagerie of robots from T-800, T-700, T-600s, T-1s, Hydrobots, Moto Terminators, you name it.
Hi, I'm John Rosengrant, and welcome to Stan Winston Studios trailer. This is our T-600, and these are new. What we've got is this is the previous generation before the T-800.
The T-600, which is a rubber skin Terminator that was originally introduced in T-1. The rubber skin Terminators, though, you could tell that they weren't human. They're also something like 7'3", so they're bigger and clunkier.
The big, massive, hulking Terminators. They've got the Terminator endoskeleton, but it's more. They're just massive.
The idea is that the T-600s are all out in the field, so they're kind of battered and weathered with kind of a simplistic rubber skin that's been pulled over the face to kind of camouflage it, and then ragtag clothing to sort of get rid of the endoskeleton.
Hey!
Created the T-600 as both a puppet and also a combination of CG and a suit. We have Brian Steele, who's our T-600 suit performer, and he's inside of a suit that's essentially a blue screen suit, but has 3/4 of the parts on his suit.
You know, the mix of what's here and real and practical, and then a performance, and then taking it by removing all this and putting in the robot parts, we'll take it somewhere that Just couldn't do otherwise.
The T-700 are black metal Terminators. They are first generation of the T-800s. They're beginning to have human skin.
So this is our T-700 robot. In the world that we're in, we've seen the T-600. That was the big 7'3" guy. Now we're coming down to like a 6'9" version. So this is the T-700. Again, he's made out of steel, so he's rusty, he's metally, and he has the reality of the T-800 that we obviously know from the previous movies, but he's just a little bit more brutal.
For the first time, we see every piece of a hunter-killer. We only got to see parts of them in Jim's movie.
Overall, what we were really going for was to give it kind of a carapace, kind of beetle-like shell on top, and really going for all these kind of nasty little mechanical bits underneath that almost looks like when you turn over a cockroach or something like that. And you really get to see that it is a flying, deadly robot.
The biggest Terminator is the Harvester. The Harvester is about 50-foot tall. As he comes in, he's huge, he's powerful. But again, we still have to obey the laws of what have been set forward in the Terminator movies. We still have to have the pistons that work as biceps. We still have to have all the moving parts of the T-800. So what we've done is we've sort of scaled that up, made it a big, brutal beast that comes and gets the humans.
We really wanted to create something that was kind of based on the stuff that we know about, like buses and trucks and stuff that emit toxic fumes, and we wanted to make it feel like the Harvester is being powered by something. It's a big nasty machine that doesn't care about humans. It doesn't mind about polluting the earth and destroying everything that's green. So just having it emit smoke feels like there's an engine powering it. And plus it just looks cool.
The Hydrobots, which are water-based Terminators, very much in the vein of like eels, but like 7 feet or 8 feet long, and they're intense and really scary.
Well, these Hydrobots were challenging, not only because of how detailed they were. They had the circumstances that they were gonna be in. They were gonna get punished pretty hard. They have to work in water, so that adds a whole new variable there. And it needed to be durable enough to be wrestled and thrown around and chucked out of helicopters and punched through things, but at the same time not be so unwieldy that you couldn't puppet it and make it work. I started out helping build the first Terminator, and here I am now overseeing all of the animatronics and makeup effects in Terminator Salvation.
I love it when you see people who are just obsessed with what they do. These guys are obsessed with building models. They take it very, very seriously, and I think that's wonderful.
Action is incredibly important to the Terminator movies. So we did a combination of new things that people hadn't seen before, and then also doing fun little twists that sort of echo in previous Terminator movies. So just by combination of wanting to be true to the trilogy, but then also taken to the next level was our daily motivation.
McGee has made a good choice to keep it as practical as possible, but ultimately it comes down to the same thing, that in order to make a good story, you've got to try and make it intimate in some fashion.
So, you know, where we might have done, say, the fire's miniature or some kind of digital fire in a different movie, we really have been trying to keep these full-scale effects that we can shoot with our, you know, sort of traditional camera gear, camera cars, helicopters, things like that, to give it much more of a realistic feeling and kind of a raw feeling.
On this particular film, we've done three huge explosions. One being this napalm run, the other one being the gas station, and then we did some pretty large car explosions.
This is big. McGee really wanted real and explosions and action sort of at one-to-one scale.
I hate action for action's sake. There will be no noise in this movie. Everything is motivated, every shot matters. It's gotta be that level of excellence.
I love explosions like anyone else, but I love that we're taking a new take on it.
This particular napalm explosion is about 1,100 gallons of gas, stretching out for 300 feet. It's all time delayed with delayed detonators. So when it fires, it'll be like a machine gun strafe of fireballs. The whole thing will be over in about 6 or 7 seconds.
In this film, I wanted everything to be in camera and real and practical. So when we decided to blow things up like the gas station or the napalm blast on the periphery of Connor's outpost, we did that for real.
Here we are at the gas station. Marcus and Kyle have gone in looking for some food. They're looking for some fuel. Before we can get to the conclusion of the scene, we're interrupted by the Harvester that's represented in height by these cranes up here that come in and extract two individuals and push Kyle, Marcus, and Star out as they try to go back to the Jeep, but before they can get there, everything's exploded and all hell breaks loose. So we've gone to great lengths to build this into one shot. It requires a lot of rehearsal, and now we're trying to get it done. Let's see what happens.
We built the gas station from the ground up, and it also had to be rigged for stunts to get these people plucked out of there. It had to be rigged for special effects because the whole thing had to collapse. It also had to look like, you know, a post-nuclear bomb had rolled through there.
Everything from the inclusion of bigger machines to bigger explosions was miles away than what I thought.
The main explosion effect was a gasoline tanker exploding as a diversion, a way to sort of destroy one of the bad guys in the film. So we had to take a 28-foot tanker and recreate it with lightweight, thin materials that we could blow up safely. So I think we had a fireball that went in the neighborhood of 300 feet in the air. That was pretty fun.
Terminator Salvation had opportunities to use the best of the visual effects techniques we have today, combine new and old techniques in great ways, but also gave us a chance to push the envelope.
We used eye mocap on set so we could replicate that physical contact between the CG creatures and the actors.
The Grey Actor is here to give us multiple references. First, it helps to get a proper action for Connor. Second, it helps the director as well to get a proper interface with the actor or with the character that will be. And then also, his suit is gray, and that will give us a good information on the lighting as well.
It's really good to have a stuntman there doing the role of the Terminator. It helps the actors because it gives them a connection to their adversary. It helps our animators because it gives them some sense of motion. And it helps the editors and filmmakers in post-production because they can cut around it.
Every Terminator picture has made a contribution to visual effects. So we would never be so bold as to say, wow, we've matched that, we've made our contribution. But we wanted to do something. So I challenged ILM, Ben Snow in particular, what can you do to create an early 80s Arnold Schwarzenegger photorealistically appearing in our film in 2009?
The Arnie that we're trying to match is the Arnie from 20 years ago. So we did have various scans and masks that have been made from Arnie back in the original Terminator. But it quickly became clear that it's not necessarily just the shape of a head which makes someone look like them. So much of it is the movement, it's the mannerisms, and that turned out to be quite a challenge.
What I pitched to Charlie and to McGee was, okay, we are going to take footage from Terminator 1, and for every shot we have in our movie, we're going to look at that footage and say, what is his performance here? And use those to guide our performance.
So creatively, we didn't know if we were going to use a CG Arnold or just go an alternative route. So this is one of those other plans that we had where we came up from John Connor shooting his chest to what would continue up into an endoskeleton skull. So it kind of gave us the freedom and flexibility to go down a completely different route should the CG Arnold not be the path that we want to take.
Couldn't believe the realism that they create. You know, I don't know what it's going to look like when it's completely digitally altered, but you know, hopefully it's something special.
This basically has every different trick in the book, whether it's animatronics, special effects, visual effects, stunts, you name it, this film has done it. I think that Terminator Salvation sets out to be more than a sequel. It really tries to open up the world of Terminator.
When you look at it, it doesn't look like any of the other Terminators. It looks so different.
Everything had to be new, but we wanted to respect the mythology. The difference here is we are referencing T1 and T2 and T3, but just not wishing to imitate any of the filmmaking from that.
It's a new look at Terminator that has tons of classic things in it, so it's really interesting and cool at the same time.
We're holding true to what the mythology set up, and we're making it bigger and better and louder.
I wanted to reinvigorate the franchise where you honor mythology, but you begin again in a great many ways, and that was our goal.